After waiting for 8 months in a restricted hostel, our undercover journalist was finally cleared to go for a pre-travel training instituted by the ministry. In the last episode, she narrated the frustrating experiences in the restricted hostel where they suffered poor hygiene conditions and food supply, which led to sacking of the matron and guard. Today, she continues with what happened at the training for the final journey to Saudi Arabia. Our undercover journalist phoned many other groups of girls from other companies. Others were in classes learning. Uncommonly, every girl was in a hijab or sharia, long dresses or skirts and sagging, their heads veiled. It was a school or institution of sorts. It was a large place, encircled by a perimeter wall, with a training hall, dormitories, offices and other buildings. There were so many girls from other companies like Atlas Recruitment Company, Explorer Dubai Limited, Eskom Link Limited, Skynet, Migade International Limited, Al-Fijairaha International. On arrival, the girls were gathered in a classroom for briefing by the college staff, a dark-skinned, tall gentleman. Our journalist later discovered was Solomon Akankwasa. She started being scared because someone she knew would identify her. She pulled her face mask to cover most of her face. Suddenly, Akankwasa fixed his eyes on her, saying that he knew her. Anyway, while briefing the girl, he gave them expectations while in the college. He told them that the dress code was the key and those who were not in hijab must get one. He said the heads must be veiled between 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. while on training. The college prepares the girls to get used to the dress code. He also asked them to behave in a civil manner and be considerate of each other's tribes, religions, and appearances. He said regardless of their differences, they were united by one mission, to go to Saudi Arabia and earn 1 million shillings in exchange of their labor. The college canteen asked the girls to buy hijab at 8,000 shillings. It must be either white or black. Aisha, the company operator from Zion, asked us to pay 3,000 shillings each and the company would contribute 5,000 shillings. To the girl's disappointment, she never bought for them hijab at the canteen. She went to a winter market and bought old and unironed hijabs, smelling like used clothes. It was a residential training. Sleeping quarters were behind the main hall that hosted the training, and each of the girls were asked to get a colleague to share a bed with. The dormitory had double-decker beds, each bed with two occupants. There was not enough space in corridors and girls would quarrel as they pulled beds apart in order to pass. Each bed had a mattress, so what was required was a bedsheet, blanket or duvet. In the second shift, 35 more girls from Zion were brought in, and later at night, more 100 plus. A stranger girl asked to share a bed with our undercover journalist and they slept differently, one facing in the head and another the foot to avoid facial contact. In spite of what Akankwasa had preached to the girls, there was no way they could achieve harmony with so many girls gathered together in one place. They were like co-wives together in one place. Lots of envy, mockery, bullying, fights, gossips, and discrimination. The syllabus contained the bulk of useless stuff, but some measure of useful ones too. Classes were only 3 per day, and the two permanent teachers were Solomon Akankwasa and Boaz Amporeire. What our undercover journalist found useless was like being taught how to behave while in homes, maintain hygiene, respect bosses, and also dress unveiling heads. Those were simple things you wouldn't expect in training. Most of it were rules that governed Kadama. Kadama is an Arabic word for maid or house girl. The girls were going to Saudi Arabia to be kadamas, so they taught them how not to use a phone, not to eat or sleep before their bosses. The functional, useful information was how to open saving diaspora accounts, presented by one Jacob, who came from Centenary Bank. In fact, after his talk, girls opened up accounts with Centenary Bank, paying 10,000 shillings for account opening. Trainer Dennis Kanabi, who said he was a hotelier, taught the girls proper way to do laundry, good personal hygiene, and how to prepare good food. They were also taught how to operate appliances like washing machine, blender, oven, and using a rice cooker. Najib Yusufu taught the girls what happens in Saudi Arabia, the Arab culture, their social behavior, dress code, feeding, leisure, and differences between there and Uganda. He also warned them to expect such challenges as language barrier, less sleep, homesickness, risk of body part theft, and different weather. Other challenges, he said, would be racism, different feeding, harsh bosses, insults, overworking, sexual harassment, hostile forces. But whatever happens, Yusuf asked the girls not to poke nose into their employers' businesses or gossip about the family. He also taught them basic words in Arabic like greetings, how to say cup, water, food, I am sick, man, woman, child, etc. In the next episode, our undercover journalist narrates her flight to Saudi Arabia.